So I'm with an Air Force comrade of mine, comrade in arms from Yudorn, Thailand, Yudorn Royal Thai Air Force Base in 1970 to 72. I was an enlisted man in the Air Force, and our guest here, Lieutenant Colonel Tony Marshall, retired, was a backseater,
Ewo,
electronic warfare officer in the back of F-4D Phantom 2s in the 13th TAC Fighter Squadron and the 432nd Tactical Reconnaissance Wing. So, Colonel Marshall, when did you enter the Air Force?
I joined in 1964 when I went to the Air Force Academy, graduated in 1968, and from there I went through NAV training at Mather, following basic NAV training
in Northern California,
Sacramento, yep. Rancho Cordova. Graduating from undergraduate navigator training, I went to electronic warfare, or EWO, school. From there I got an F-4 assignment, went through Fairchild for survival school in Washington, went to Davis-Monthan in Tucson for the radar lead-in for the F-4, and then to MacDill for the replacement training unit, which turned into an operational assignment. That was 1971, and from there, actually it was 1970, spent a year at MacDill, and then in 71 headed over to Yudorn, Thailand for my first combat tour. The wonderful 13th.
The 13th TAC Fighter Squadron and the 432nd. And let's see, you were there how long?
I was there for a normal one-year tour.
Right.
And then I, for some foolish reason, decided to extend.
You were asking for it.
Yes, but I was having fun.
Yeah.
So I extended, and my tour was up in April. I flew until July. And then that last mission ended up jumping out over North Vietnam. And
tell us a little bit about that sortie. What was the objective? And you were in what aircraft? And then what happened?
Okay, we were actually in an F-4E doing FASTVAC, which is forward air controller. And our job was to mark targets for bombers. Mm-hmm. And on our last pass, we were marking targets for folks that were dropping smart bombs. And apparently we got a little low. The centerline fuel tank, we surmised, malfunctioned. Put the airplane out of control, too low, so the front seater pulled the ejection handles and we both went out, got one swing in the chute. I got picked up fairly quickly and he never made it back, and we presume he got shot resisting.
So we lost the pilot on that mission. And how long had he been in the unit by then?
This was my first mission with him. He was TDY from Clark. And the first time I'd ever flown with him, but he had been there probably 3 months. He may have had a previous tour, but on this tour it was just 3 months.
So you were almost immediately captured, and then you were taken directly to prison, or how did that work?
It took 5 days to get up the trail from, we were captured near Van, took 5 days moving up the trail, moving at night, and the fifth day we ended up in Hanoi. I was processed into the Hanoi Hilton. Spent about a month there, and then they transferred me to the zoo, which was their show camp. And then stayed there pretty much until the bombing started, went back to the Hilton for a while. And then once the war was over, back to the zoo for the release sequence.
So you were basically just arriving in Hanoi at about the time that Nixon was taking over and releasing B-52s to bomb the airfields, which had not been permitted up to that point.
Correct. And that's when we got serious about winning this. And it was very obvious when you saw the Vietnamese, their reaction when the B-52s started. They had always been up there pointing out and getting things done down south, but this hit directly home. So they knew we were serious at that point.
Well, so you were in jail, as you say, for how many months total?
9 months, so relatively short time. And as I tell people, it's all relative. So compared to the folks that spent 7-8 years and got tortured, it was a mild experience.
You had a chance to mess with them a little bit, I think, in your stories.
I did have fun. They told me right away they were not going to bother me, that they had to keep me until it was over. And again, it was fairly certain that it was going to be over pretty soon. So I treated it as if I was at survival school, mm-hmm. graduate level.
Right.
So I took every opportunity I could to try things.
Now, on the Freedom flights home, you were on the first or second flight?
I was on the very last flight.
Because you were the very last to get there, almost.
The order of release was based on length of time up there, factoring in injuries. Those who were injured got to go with the first group. I was uninjured. I was a relatively new person there. And the ironic thing is we were split into four groups. As the fourth group was ready to depart, the Vietnamese decided to get back at us, and they said that our side was violating the agreement, so they had to keep some of us. And the person in front of me got to go on schedule, and I got to stay along with 59 others behind me.
For how much longer?
Just another day. It was another silly little game they played.
All right, so you came back. Everybody's excited. Your mother, if I remember you telling the story, was very taciturn.
Yes, my mother was very level emotionally. They noted in the SAR report that when they reported to her that I was missing, their expression was no emotional reaction. She just said thank you very much and went about her business.
He's going to be fine. I know he is because I trained him.
Right. And her thing was, what can I do about it at this point? Is there any point in getting emotionally crazy? No, there's nothing I can do. Things are going to work out. And that was the way she was built. So I was very proud of her.
So you come back to the U.S. You're still in the Air Force. You've been repatriated, a lot of debriefing, a lot of medical and stuff. And so by the time you arrive, how long before you're back on active flight status?
They gave us the option to take time off to recoup, so I took a year off. And then I went to pilot training, which is what I'd been asking for all along.
In
1974,
right.
I went to pilot training, got back in the F-4, and continued my career and retired after 22 years total.
And you went to work for the airlines.
Then, when the Air Force and I got tired of each other, I retired after 22 years and got hired by United and flew for the next 16 and a half years with them before they put me out when I turned 60. So I have no complaints. It was a great career.
Nothing but flying. Nothing but net.
Right.
Yeah.
Perfect.
And just a little additional promotion for you. You've been working with kids ever since.
I've been working with kids ever since, trying to find kids that may not have been exposed to aviation and letting them know what they're missing out on, but even if they don't want to fly, just trying to get them to do something with their lives. So today I've brought one of my students with me, and he got a chance to fly.
And it's been one of my great pleasures just to stumble over this guy on the internet after carrying around photographs of him and Fred Olmsted at my debriefing table in 1972. And Tony is a great photographer. If you ever have a chance to see him at any of the many gatherings he's been asked to address, make sure you do. Thanks so much for being here, Tony.
Pleasure. Anytime, Jim.